So this talk is an interesting one, I think, for those of you who have done research. And I actually started working on this way back in 2003 and sort of got it to a certain level of satisfaction and then decided I'm going to put this on the shelf. So I put it on the shelf for about 7 years, which maybe is longer than most would care. I guess I have the luxury of being in the Weather Service and not in a publish or perish environment to do that. But I've sort of just put it on the shelf and just let it sit. So what I'm going to show you is sort of like the first part, which was done in 2003, and then the more recent update to this work. The acknowledgments are from Lou Mishkin, who unfortunately has passed away, and Sean Del Duco, who used to be with Sirota but now is with Microsoft. They assisted a lot in the statistical analysis that's presented here. So the question we were trying to address was, from a Weather Service perspective or a NOAA perspective, and certainly in this building, people have been concerned a long time about tornado warnings as a performance measure of the agency. And so you see a lot of things like this where annual statistics are plotted and tracked and goals are projected out into the future. And the idea is that the Weather Service justifies its existence by the ability to meet these goals and improving in their metrics. So we have typical tornado lead times, tornado false alarm rate, where you want those to be lower, obviously, and probability detection, which the modernization was basically designed to improve. So questions that arise from these sorts of things is, how do we improve these verification statistics? How do we meet our goals, and what do we invest our resources in? Because it's a limited budget, sort of flatlined. We only have so much that we can throw at these kind of problems. So I decided to look at the question, since the tornado statistics are essentially a collective statistic of 122 WFOs, I thought, well, let's look at the top 10 WFOs, just 10, top 10, a hit list or something like that, and see what do those top 10, assuming that they're the best in the Weather Service has. So just looking at, and this was back in 2001, and the green asterisk indicates the performance of the top 10 relative to the national average. So for lead times, they were well above the national average. Probability detection, same sort of thing. And where they really stood out, the top 10 offices, which is around 10%, is in the false alarm rate, that they were well below the national average, which intuitively, if you know anything about the warning decision problem, is very significant, because of the high penalty for a missed warning tends to create a lot more warnings that are needed. So having a lower false alarm rate is indicative of something, skill or something's going on that allows those offices to have such a lower rate.
Error bounds, or they appear there.
Yes.
So the one that was outside the error bound, is, as far as be sure of improvement, was lower false alarm ratio. Is that right?
Yes. So what's going on at these offices? Why are they doing so well? So you sort of can ask basic questions. Better, they have better science and technology. Well, perhaps, but one of the cookie cutter aspects of the modernization is every office has the same sort of radar and the same sort of AWIP system, same sort of this and that. So that's not likely to be easier verification. So of these top 10 offices, there were some that were in highly densely populated areas where you could assume verification might be better, others not so. Easier storms, there's the belief held by some that, in Tornado Alley, you've got the well-behaved supercells, and so those will give you better statistics overall. More practice where you get a lot of tornadoes, period. So those, nothing, no strong, in the top offices, none of those things really stood out as they weren't all in Tornado Alley. They weren't all getting a lot of tornadoes. There's some in the East Coast, some in the plains, et cetera. So another question that sort of arose out of the blue, you could say, is what about the office culture? which is not something we typically look at from a hard science, physical science perspective, at least not in the AMS literature. So this is a definition of something called IDEO Culture that by Gary Fine, who's a professor at the University of Chicago. And so IDEO Culture, he describes as culture and interaction, how people, a group of people interact with one another and the customs they develop which last within an office. So it's a system of knowledge, beliefs, behaviors, and customs shared by members of an interacting group to which members can refer that serves as the basis for further interaction. Members recognize that they share experiences, and these experiences can be referred to with the expectation they will be understood by other members. So every group has some IDEO culture, according to Gary Fine. So NSSL has one, and SPC has one, and the WFO Norman has one, and NWC probably has one. And those IDEO cultures probably change somewhat and are modified with time and various other factors. But it's sort of like you know it when you see it. And if you've worked in different forecast offices, it's rest assured you've probably seen it right in your face, because one office has a different feel and way of acting than other ones. So the question then, and then following along on that, Gary Fine describes group culture or office culture as it incorporates traditions and practices that are tied to background knowledge, common values, group goals, and status systems, but also serves as a space in which new cultural items are performed that complement previous traditions. So this allows for the evolution of the group culture due to various factors. So that's sort of an introduction to the culture piece. Now, getting back to the hypothesis that we looked at back in 2002 was that a tornado warning is arguably the most challenging of all products issued by Weather Service forecasters. Sustained high performance in tornado warnings requires a highly trained, dedicated staff who can work well as a team under very stressful conditions. So if the effects of group or office culture are to be seen, it would be in tornado warning verification statistics. So the idea is that offices that score high in tornado warning verification statistics will also score high in employee satisfaction survey questions, which serve as a proxy for office culture compared to offices with poor tornado verification statistics. So actually, the Weather Service is a rather interesting experiment, if you will, that we have offices all across the country carrying out the same thing with different people in each office. So the idea is you have different group cultures in every office. They're all doing tornado warnings. Is there some impact of those people groups on the performance of individual offices that make them stand out or less so? So the methodology for this was obtain the essentially a snapshot of 2000, 2001 tornado warning statistics for each Weather Service office, ranked them by skill using the CSI, and then requested an aggregate of NOAA had at the time in 2002 an all-employee survey called the SFA. And so I requested an average survey for the top 10 and bottom 10 offices in CSI, and then compared the results.